Welcome back. So now we have a session on causality program. So we have three talks in the session, and the first talk is very
great. Thanks, everyone. I'm Angela, here with the causality program. I'm going to tell you about an overview of my work on credible inference, and I'll do that by providing a high-level overview of this talk on minimax optimal policy learning under unobserved confounding. So first, let me start with a very high-level overview of why it is that we want to use causal inference to make personalized decisions from data before I talk about the challenges of observational data. And so when treatment effects are heterogeneous, that implies that we can improve decision theoretically by not assigning the same treatment to everyone as on the left, but by simply tailoring treatments to those who would most benefit. And the problem with doing this is just that causal inference, although quite powerful, requires a lot of assumptions. In particular, a lot of assumptions are true by design if we're handed a randomized controlled trial, but if we're instead handed an observational data set, such as electronic medical records, and we're trying to extract prescriptive insights, it is widely known that many of these assumptions simply do not hold by virtue of our understanding about the data. And so this kind of puts us in a bind methodologically, where it seems that our two options are to incorrectly make wrong assumptions to try to extract some insight, or simply give up on the inferential task altogether. And so at an extremely high level, I'm just going to talk about some work that fills out this middle path, which is about trying to use robustness for two purposes. The first is safety in view of these violated assumptions. And the second is for estimation, to salvage what we can from our imperfect data and strengthen our estimation procedures. And so I'll briefly just put some of these works and highlight how they build out these two different directions. The first direction I'm going to focus on today is about relaxing assumptions that were too strong in the first place, namely that of unconfoundness or ignorability. This other direction is about starting from the data, thinking about what we can say without making any assumptions. Typically, this is quite conservative, but then thinking about how we can incorporate domain knowledge or structural knowledge from a very general point of view taken from math programming and optimization in order to strengthen what we can say. And there's been a lot of work on this kind of inference in many different literatures, sensitivity analysis and causal inference, partial identification and econometrics, but I'm gonna focus also on more complex domains and do these robust tasks in computationally aware ways so that we can scale them up to achieve insights in important applications with more complex estimates, such as thinking about personalizing medicine or revisiting the controversial Women's Health Initiative trial, or thinking about bounding disparities for personalized warfarin dosing. So that's a high level overview, and I'll dive into this work on minimax optimal policy learning. And the central problem that I'm going to think about here is that of unobserved confounding. So assuming I have some observational data of X covariates, treatments A, and outcomes Y, the concern with unobserved confounders is that there could be some additional unobserved information that actually affected the underlying treatment selection process or the propensity of this individual to go to their doctor, as well as their eventual health outcomes. And again, this is precluded by design in RCTs because we have complete control of the randomization process. But if someone hands you a data set and asks you to do causal inference on it, chances are quite likely that, especially if your data set comprises of decisions made by humans, those decisions reflect some kind of additional information. But on the other hand, in the big data era, we expect that there's a lot of information that we're collecting that tells us something about selection. And so that motivates a kind of sensitivity analysis approach. And let me just briefly talk through the components of this policy learning paradigm. And so given our data, typically we make this assumption of unconfoundness to do causal inference. Informally, it suggests that we have observed all of the covariates that account for the treatment selection process. What we want to do with our observational data is actually evaluate the value of a different decision policy. So think of what we would like to do as evaluating an optimal clinical decision rule and eventually optimizing over the space of classifiers to obtain a clinical decision rule, even though the only data that we have is historical and we can't run new experiments. And so the policy value is the population expectation of causal outcomes that would be induced if we assigned treatment according to this possible clinical decision rule. We want to estimate this value statistically, in particular so that we can optimize for the best classifier. In this work, we're going to focus on regrets for purposes of robustness, but the main point is that these quantities must be estimated statistically given only our historical or offline data set. And we're going to simply estimate these robustly in a way that is quite natural. So let me provide a very high-level overview of the kind of general strategy or logic. We're going to focus on how the statistical estimator for all these quantities depends on the unobserved confounding. Classically, as we know in causal inference, what matters is simply the one-dimensional propensity of the information onto the probability of treatment assignment. And so that tells us we don't need to recover like the full complex relationship between observed covariates and unobserved. We can simply focus on how it affects this one-dimensional projection. We're going to assume a less restrictive assumption, but it's still an assumption, that we can specify some ambiguity sets within which the true selection probabilities did lie. And then we're simply going to do minimax policy learning, which is a template that may seem familiar from adversarial machine learning. So we can, of course, do worst case evaluation by simply optimizing our statistical estimator over this uncertainty set. But I'm going to focus on robust policy learning. We're simply trying to find a robust classifier over this uncertainty set. And the key challenge is simply that the nature of this ambiguity is quite different from the kind of the nature of statistical uncertainty when it comes to optimization. And so let me very briefly just talk about the estimation approaches. We're going to start with inverse propensity weighted approaches. If we observed everything, we could just do causal inference as normal. What we don't know is the full information propensity score. We do observe, we can estimate its projection onto observed covariates. That's simply insufficient to completely debias our data, but it essentially provides a starting point for adversarial learning procedure. And so we're going to optimize within propensity scores that are bounded within some kind of L infinity distance between what we can estimate. And so let me briefly provide kind of high level discussion of the kinds of results, like what is it that we can say in this regime? And so these results split up into kind of two different interpretations. The first is decision theoretic, because it allows us to make a statement about your out-of-sample improvement upon the baseline policy, given the fixed data up to some kind of statistical error. The second category is more statistical, because it's just a statement about, given that you run this procedure on finite samples, what can you say about the rate of convergence? And it's again up to a statistical error. And there's a lot of improvements that could be made on the constants, but the overall high-level picture is that you can do this without losing much computationally or statistically. And so again, this kind of middle way of inference is just as hard in a very informal sense as either of these extremes. And so I talked about the single time step case. It turns out that you can also consider the sensitivity analysis for much more complex decision settings, such as infinite horizon MDPs. Of course, you're also going to require additional structural restrictions, namely that the unobserved confounding is independently drawn at every time step. But we can do this using the same kind of sensitivity model, a different kind of estimator. And what's interesting is simply trying to verify that you're controlling in the space of MDPs generating the data when you're just imposing constraints on your observed trajectory tuples. And so that's robust causal inference. I'll just very briefly talk about a couple of works that are trying to think about the interplay between causal inference in particular for informing decision-making in complex systems. And so in this first work, we simply focus our attention on an extremely restricted subclass of MDPs where sequential decision-making has been successful in practice. We read off the causal structure that is already in the literature, and we show that this leads to radically simpler statistical estimation. And in this other new work, we consider a decision setting where your utility is not just the sum of individual level utilities, but it's actually the output of some kind of downstream optimization problem. And this arises, for example, because job training or assigning personalized job training is an example touted in many machine learning papers, but domain experts are actually concerned about system level responses or general equilibrium. And the kind of technical main focus here is to remove the bias introduced by optimization. So I'll just stop there. Thank you. There are many topics I would love to talk about causal inference, statistics, optimization, taking the con out of decisions, putting the human in the loop, and many other interesting topics. Thank you. Oh, that's a very oblique reference to taking the con out of econometrics, but it's an oblique reference to all the kinds of issues with bias in the data, endogeneity from decision makers that preclude us from making decisions that achieve improvements in practice.
Let me ask one last question. Maybe it is a little bit more general, but I would like to understand it. If you go and discuss with someone that is a hematologist, for example, you will get something like 10 or 20 samples about a very rare disease in the 5-year range. So my real question is, let's assume that we have that sample and it is exactly as you had in your model, that you have the ability to see all the DNA stuff, so you do not have any extra co-founders. What typically someone can say, this is something that they would like at the end of the day, have so small
sample. Oh, is your question about what can you say with extremely small randomized samples?
Yeah,
this comes up a lot in practice. And actually in practice, what is more popular are Bayesian approaches or meta-analysis approaches. So if you go to like policy institutes, there's a lot of Bayesian modeling to account for that small sample regime in practice.
So next we have Andrea telling us about stabilizing Q learning.